Anyway, y'all happy this morning? Good. Let's get in this word this morning. I want to continue to talk about live life bold. And I think that it's important for me and you as believers that we kind of shift our life far as being bold, being courageous, stepping out there in areas that really we've already should have been. Places that God has called me and you to do so in our community, in our family, in your workplace. It's amazing how many people always are asking the church, I want to do something. I want a ministry. I want to do this. And God has got you in the greatest ministry, and most of you, it's right in your workplace. It's dead in the place that God, and you're praying that God will move you out of there, and God's saying, no, I put you there. So we need to learn how to live life bold. The word bold means willingness to take risk and act with courage. I believe so many times in the church we believe that people has to have pedigrees or degrees or doctrine in order for God to use them at a great level. We have some kind of mindset in the church that there's such a great qualification on somebody to work for the kingdom of God. But I'm thankful this morning God doesn't look at things the way we look at them. So real quick, our scripture is Proverbs 28, verse 1. And you can look at this one, and we'll let you turn your Bibles just in a second, I promise. I don't want you to feel like you ain't been in church this morning. Proverbs 28, verse 1. Can you cut me down just a hair bit, please? Thank you. These monitors are around me. Proverbs 28, verse 1. Can we get that? Thank you so much. It says, the righteousness are as bold as lions. The righteousness are as bold as lions. This mic is going to cut it, guys. We really got to get that fixed. Can I have that other mic, please? Where's it at? Thank you. The righteous are as bold as lions. It don't say the smartest, the most educated. It doesn't say the greatest. But what I like about this scripture, it says the righteous are as bold as lions. God is looking for somebody, the plain, the nobodies, to be bold, to act in courage, or to take risk. God is looking for the nobodies, those that's been pushed away, those that's been rejected, those that's been on the outskirts. God has got an eye for those that's been down here. And I'm not saying that all of us has always been down here, but I think that a seed produces its own kind. So I know the company of people that surrounds me, and me and you came from the rejected, the push away, those that wasn't too educated, those that wasn't. We just are people that knows the righteousness of God, and God is qualifying some people to say, use me, God. That's what he's looking for. The plain. The nobodies to be bold. Everybody expect Billy Graham to preach, but they never expected me and you to preach. Amen? Well, now turn with me to 1 Corinthians 1. And let's get in this morning. 1 Corinthians 1, starting with verse 26. Amen?
Yeah.
It says, brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. Isn't that funny? It's the funniest thing. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are. So that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us the wisdom from God. That is our righteousness and holiness and redemption. Isn't that good right there? Listen what the Message Bible says. It says, take a good look, friends, at who you were when you got called into this life. I don't see many of the brightest and the best among you. Not many influential, not many from high society families. It's obvious that God deliberately chose men and women that the culture overlooks and exploits and abuses. Chose these nobodies to expose the hollow pretensions of the somebodies. That makes it quite clear that none of you can get by with blowing your own horn before God. Everything that we have, right thinking and right living, a clean state, a fresh start, comes from God by the way of Jesus Christ. That's why we have the saying, if you're going to blow a horn, blow a trumpet for God. Come on, somebody. If you're going to blow a horn, blow a trumpet for God. I love that. So God chooses the foolish, the weak, and the lowly people to do great things. Why? So they may not boast of them on themselves. Have you ever heard the story of the woodpecker? No? Good. There was a woodpecker that was on a big old tree, and he was pecking away on that tree. Peck, 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 peck. All of a sudden, lightning struck that tree he was on. Split that tree dead in half, fell to the ground, and that woodpecker just stood back and looked at it. Stared at it. Then he flew away. A few minutes later, he flew back with 9 to 15 other woodpeckers. And he said, look what I did. That's why God's looking for the nobodies. Because we know without him, amen, it is impossible for me and you to achieve what we achieve every day in our life. Because we know that we cannot make it a day without Jesus in our life. We cannot make it a day without his word. We cannot make it a day without his spirit. We cannot make it a day without worship. We know without God, we would be miserably and we would fail at life. But with God, we have found that we can do anything that we put our minds to if we're willing to be bold and courageous and go after the kingdom of God. Come on, nudge your neighbor and say, he's talking to you this morning. Come on, tell your neighbor, say, don't be no woodpecker.
No woodpeckers.
No woodpeckers. So God has learned to take the ordinary and put greatness behind them. God has took the ordinary people and he's put greatness in them to be bold and courageous. When greatness comes out of greatness, nobody will ever praise God. Did y'all hear me? When greatness comes out of greatness, nobody will praise God. But when greatness comes out of weakness and foolishness, everybody will worship God. Come on, somebody. What everybody else overlooks, that's God's grade A candidate for his list. Come on, somebody shout, be bold.
Be bold.
If me and you, I believe with everything in me, If me and you would have to get a team to go out and take over this world, knowing God's word, knowing and understanding where we've come from, I believe me and you would still look for the best. I'm just going to be honest. It's just like in school. If we were playing football or kickball when I was a kid, listen, I always had to be a captain. Why? Because I always got the first pick, because I always got the next best to me. I had to have somebody could kick, had to have somebody could run fast, had somebody could tackle, had to have somebody aggressive, so I looked for the best. And I believe if me and you were putting a team together to go out into the world, our community, we would probably still pick the smartest. We'd probably go look for the one that had it all together. I don't believe any of you would probably go to the drug house. I don't believe any of you would go to the biker, the tattooed, and the, you know what I'm saying, the castaway. I believe that. Why? Because that's the way that we look. That's the way we do things. I'm thankful that God don't do it like me and you. I'm thankful He looks for those that's rough around the edges. I'm thankful that He come to the drug house and got somebody like me. Come on, are you with me? That keeps me humbled every single day that I get to do what I get to do for the kingdom of God. And I know that I don't deserve this life. I know that me and you don't deserve to do what we get to do. But it keeps me humble to know that God picked somebody like me with no education, with an F average, but God says, I love you and I'm going to put my finger on you. That keeps me humble, but it also keeps me bold and courageous. Why? Because I've got the heavens by backing me up and behind me as we enter into a fight. That makes sense. People from all my teachers and friends are still at disbelief that I still preach. They still ask the same silly question. Are you still preaching? I'm like, no, it's only temporary. No, when God does something, He does it for good. That's who He is. Me and you have to come to a place of understanding that God can use me and you. Nudge your neighbor. Say, yes, you. Be bold. Be courageous. I want you guys to understand that because many of us today come from a difficult lifestyle. Me and you've come from a tough part of our life. All of us in here this morning probably has an amazing testimony. Has an amazing testimony of God's grace and God's goodness and His mercy in our life. All of us, I believe, can look back and look on the journey and know that God has been with us every step of the way. Many of us in here today knows that we didn't get handed down millions and millions of dollars, which I wish we would have, but we didn't. We have to work. We have to dig. We have to hustle every day. We didn't have the smartness that other people had. We didn't have all the things that the world counts as good or perfect.
Come on.
But God is looking for people like me and you. God is looking for people like me and you to be bold and courageous. Yep. To do the work of the kingdom.
Amen.
Can you believe that? That He takes somebody that is ignorant, foolish, the world looks at, and says, I'm going to put my finger on you. I'm going to anoint you.
Come on.
Yes.
I'll never forget a teacher looked at me one time at a parent-teacher conference and looked at my mother and said, you might as well, and I was a sophomore, he said, you might as well go ahead and let him quit because he's never going to amount to nothing. Come on. I wished I knew God back then. Because I'd have put the Holy Ghost on him. Come on, somebody. But in my mind, I was thinking, he's right. But never knew the plans God had for me. Some of you still feel like you're no good. Some of you still feel like you're a misfit or you don't belong. Some of you still feel like God cannot use you. But I've come to give you a word this morning. He's looking for exactly the people and the person that you are to be bold and courageous in the day that we live in. Are you with me? I don't know about you, but that's the ones I want to go to war with.
Yes.
You hear me? That's come from the rough edges, you know, the castaways. Come on, somebody. That's the ones I want to go to war with. That's the one I want to be protected. It's just like the woman that got caught in the act of adulteress. Jesus was willing to put his finger in her dirt. God is wanting and God is not afraid to put his finger in your dirt today. Come on. He wants to make you great for him. So don't dare sit in your life today thinking God don't love me. God don't want to use me. God don't like me. God couldn't use somebody like me. I'm telling you that God died for your dirt. I'm thankful that God was willing to put his finger all in my mess. And he still does today. Unworthy am I, but he's still willing to say, go get them in my name. Come on, somebody. Go ahead and poke your neighbor a little bit. Say, he'll put his finger in your dirt. He'll put his finger in your dirt. So I thought about a few examples of people that me and you would never use. So I thought about Pharaoh and his army that was the boldest, the toughest, the meanest that held God's people captive, held them hostage. So God saw Moses. Hear me this morning. He saw Moses at 80 years old.
Come on.
With a walking cane in his hand.
Come on. Yeah.
That spent the last 40 years of his life being a convict running from the law.
Come on.
And he had a speech problem. So God says, I'm going to take a man with a cane that's 80 years old, that's been running from the law because of all the junk he got himself in. God says, I want him to go in front of the meanest, the toughest of Pharaoh and say, let God's people go. Does that make sense to any of you this morning? If me and you were going to the fight, no disrespect to the 80-year-olds. But if I can get 240s, I'm going to. But God don't look it like that. He can take a man, and he didn't have the cane for protection. He had his cane because he couldn't walk. Feeble, 80 years old, with a speech problem that's been running from the law 40 years of his life. God saying, I want you. Can you imagine Moses saying, you want me, God? I want you to go stand in the face of the devil and tell him to let my people go. Come on. How funny is that? How crazy is that? It's the same as your life. You look at yourself like Moses did. I've got this problem and I've got that problem. But I'm telling you that God's saying, I need you for my kingdom. Woo, tell your neighbor, say, he needs you. He needs you. Then I thought about Jonah. That's automatically.
Jonah.
God. God was looking for somebody to go preach to a people that was a rebellious nation, it said. And the whole time he was running down Jonah, he was being rebellious.
Come on.
It cracks me up when I read these stories. The whole journey of Jonah going to preach to Nineveh was that he was rebelling and telling God no. He tried to slip God, and the whole time God was beating rebellion out of him so that he could go and preach rebellion. My God, are y'all hearing me? God's looking for people like you. That's why you've been through what you've been through. Because God's looking for a person like you to go preach to people just like you would. Woo! Are you with me this morning? He's not looking for a bunch of woodpeckers. He's looking for somebody that says, I know where I came from. I know where God brought me from. I know how bad I was. I know how awful I was. I know I'll never forget. I'll never tear the rearview mirror off in my life, because I'll always want to know where God has brought me, so to keep me humble and to keep me anointed and to keep me in the favor of God. Ever heard such? He gets swallowed by a freaking whale. Come on. If people were looking and not in your window, they're like, these people are crazy. If somebody could look through the windows of church and watch how we worship sometimes, they'd be like, they're crazy. They're out of their minds. They don't get it. Why? Because we don't live in the natural. How could you go tell a rebellious nation that you just got eat by well and he spit you back out? They're going to freak out. Why, we don't live in the natural. People look like at mine in your life and they're like, them people are crazy. I know where they come from. They remember you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come on.
They remember who you are. They remember where you've come from.
That's right.
They'll never forget the face. And they may try to dodge you at Walmart because you're a little freakier now than you were. Because you got connected with Jesus and he changed everything. Yeah. I believe it says it like this. That all the sins of your life got cast as far as the east is from the west. And he changed who you are. The old man died and a new covenant. Come on. That's why they couldn't believe Paul when he came in. Because they thought, just 2 weeks ago that joker was killing Christians. Down in Jesus, the Messiah Christ. Now look at him. Jesus does things overnight. Do you hear me?
Yes,
let me tell you something. 1 minute with a king would change your life forever. I'll never forget the Sunday evening that I got saved. Sunday morning I was drinking a beer by the pool, waiting on my family to get home. Sunday evening I went and poured out 32 beers out of my refrigerator. Are you with me? I ain't one by one. 32 of them. Why? Because 1 minute with a king changes everything. Changes. People would be looking inside of my window, would have said, that guy has a lot. He just spent $70 on beer yesterday and he's pouring it out today. Why? I had a counter reaction. Why? I lost the possession of the enemy and got possessed by the Holy Spirit. Come on, somebody. And I thought about David. The very day that David ran into Goliath, do y'all know what he was doing? Huh? He was delivering cheese to his brothers. I think it's Pepper Jack. He was delivering cheese. You hear me? He was delivering cheese. When Samuel came to anoint a new king, David wasn't even invited to the anointing party. Everybody else got involved, but not David. Can you imagine the rejection that he felt? That when he turned up the horn to anoint a new king, the oil never moved.
That's right. Come on.
He was like,
come on.
Come on. Yeah, you know how we used to do with them old ketchup bottles? Thank God for squirts. Come on. Because I used to beat the fart out of that bottle. That's what he was doing, he thought. He's like, do you got any more kids? He's like, well, yeah, I got one more. He's out in the sheep herd. Listen, God's always going to anoint the one that's working. You hear me? I got one, he's out in the field. The rest of them was suited up, looking nice, ready for their calling. And you had David out pumping with cut off pants, no sleeves on his shirt. Come on, redneck looking, redheaded, just scrappy looking fella. Been out with the sheep, got sheep poop all over him, probably stunk. And he heard his daddy holler. He thought, what is he want? I'm busy. God will always anoint the busy, the one that's doing something. Come on, somebody. Can you imagine when he walked up? He felt out of place. He wasn't suited for the party. He didn't bring a gift for it. Everybody was looking nice and clean, and here he come in his sheep attire.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And said, y'all want me? And all of a sudden, the oil starts flowing.
Come on.
Listen, nobody else can get your oil. The only time that oil is going to flow is when me and you are willing to step under it.
Come on, that's right.
Come on, are you with me?
Yes.
He's looking for me and you to be bold and courageous for him. Listen to this, Judges 15, verse 15. Says Samson took a fresh jawbone of a donkey. He grabbed it and struck down 1,000 men. Then Samson said, with a donkey's jawbone, I have made donkeys of them. With a donkey's jawbone, I have killed 1,000 men. And that day, it says, they called that Jawbone Hill.
Come on.
I love what he said. He said, I've made donkeys of them.
Come on.
He took a fresh donkey's jaw. Look, you go and tell somebody this story, they're going to report you to the police. Said, these people have lost their mind. God is looking for somebody to be bold and courageous that he can use to call men, to cause men to feel like a bunch of donkeys again. God's still looking for people like me and you to cause the wise and the intelligent to feel like a donkey.
That's right.
I'd rather use the other word, but we'll stay with donkey.
Come on, sir.
God is looking for people like me and you to make them feel like he did, like a bunch of donkeys. Stop answering God with I'm not qualified. Stop answering God with I'm not capable. Stop answering God with I don't have the right training. Stop answering God saying I'm not smart enough. Stop answering God with I'm not outgoing. Stop answering God with I'm not confident in front of people. And just start answering him with send me, God. Send me. Send me. So that's what he's looking for. Look at your neighbor and say, he's looking for that. Matthew 22, verse 14, I'm fixing to close. Says, for many are called, but a few are chosen. Now, just real quick, I need you to be attentive because I want you to only kind of show you what this means. The word called in this scripture comes from a Greek text. Means all. all of us was called. The word chosen in this scripture in Matthew in the Greek means accept. All of us are called, but only a few will accept their calling in life. See, I believe that when something dies, it goes back to which it came from. That makes sense? If we die in this life, the Bible says our bodies goes back to the dust in which it came from. That's why I do not believe in burning me. I was not created from ashes. Listen, I've spent my life trying to dodge fire, and I don't want you to burn this old mortal body when I'm out. I understand that I'm gone, I'm not part of, but still, just something about that fire bothers me. But the Bible says that we go back to which we came from. Listen, our bodies goes back to the ground, and the Bible says from absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. That makes sense. Our bodies goes back to the dirt, and our spirit souls goes to be with Jesus. Absent from this body means present with the Lord. And that tells me that all, I believe that because Jeremiah said this, I knew you before you were formed. So therefore, I came from God, and I'll go back to God. Now, I don't know how I was in God. It's not explainable. It doesn't make it clear if I was on God's mind, or if I was in God's heart, or if I was literally there. But he tells me before I was ever formed in the womb of my mother, he knew me, and he knew the hairs upon mine and your head. He's got them counted. So therefore, before I ever came through my mama, me and you had a, regardless if you're an atheist, regardless if you believe or you came from God and you had a purpose of being on this earth. Are you with me? So I believe that when my body goes back to the dirt, my spirit goes back to God just that quick. I don't believe that there's a place in there that we're just hanging out and waiting in purgatory. I'm not waiting. I believe that when we die in this body, boom, I'm back with Jesus.
Come on.
And I believe that before me and you was ever formed, God had a purpose for me and you. That's why I believe in Matthew 20. For many are called. What he was saying, many of you, all of you, had a was called, had a job he gave anointing to. But once we get here on this life, only a few of us accept that calling. Are you with me? He's called us to be bold and courageous. Listen, purpose equals happiness. So many people fill their life with stuff, money, things. Are you with me? That's why, listen, I have found happiness because why? I found my purpose. Regardless if we ever have stuff, regardless if we ever have lots of money, I'm still going to be happy. Why? Because I know my purpose. All of us have the purpose. It's up to all of us to accept it. Isn't that crazy? That we were with God before we got into our mother's womb. He just let our mama bar us for nothing.
That's right. That's right.
Listen, now that curse that was put over me growing up, I'm sure many of y'all probably heard this. You only happened by accident. Oh, no. No, God knew.
Amen.
He had me in heaven. He's like, Chad,
God doesn't make mistakes.
Chad, I'm finna send you on a journey. That's why he said the chosen, those that are chosen are chosen in the fire, in the furnace, not in the silver.
Yeah.
He said, I'm going to send you on a journey. You're going to be a loud mouth, red-headed, rebellious. Come on, somebody. You're going to try everything that you can try before the age of 20, and I'm going to shift everything in your life. And he just said, "Go do it."
Come on, Jesus.
Listen, first of all, I deny the curse over some of you that you've lived all your life.
Yes.
You never was an accident.
Amen.
I want to say that again. You were never an accident. Regardless if your mother or father is around, or they've rejected you, or pushed you away, or abused you, they'll answer before Abba, your father.
Yes.
Come on, are y'all hearing me? So we denounce that curse already.
Yes.
Purpose equals happiness.
Yes.
Yes.
Woo, it fires me up.
Yes,
who would just accept that? That curse is broke over you this morning. Come on, I believe that. Isn't it good? God knew me before my mama did. God knew me before my daddy did. That's so good to me. That's why it's important that we don't have religion, that we have relationship.
Amen.
That's why it's so easy to get to know. Jesus doesn't make it hard for you to know him.
That's right.
It's not complicated. He's looking for surrender. He don't make it difficult. We don't have to go through all of this religion and whom and the ha's and all. No, he makes it so easy for me and you to love him. Why? Because once you get with him, you're like, You ever been around somebody you thought, man, do I know you?
Yeah.
When we get with Jesus, it's like we've known him for years.
Right. Yeah.
That's why things happen so fast when you get saved. Because your relationship with him is so much more important.
Yes.
Come on, let's stand to our feet.
Good work, brother.
Live life bold and courageous. Purpose equals happiness. Let me say that again. Purpose equals happiness. Some of you have been searching all your life for a little piece of joy or happiness. We've tried everything. Brother, I've tried everything. Drugs, alcohol, crack, meth. I've tried everything. And there's a saying that's going around in our culture that once somebody does meth, they're hung for life. Oh, no.
That's right.
Yet have they met our God.
Yeah.
I understand if they can't get off in the 12 steps.
Come on.
But I have found it very much percentage of high rate. All you got to do is take one step to God. He'll walk the rest of it away. It's a curse that we put over our society. Well, once you're an addict, you're always an addict. That's a lie.
Yes.
That's a lie.
Amen.
Listen. Purpose equals happiness. Everything in this world wants to stop you from your purpose.
Yes.
That's why it wants to tell you you'll always be an alcoholic, you'll always be an addict, that a meth will never recover. All these things is keeping you from one thing. Your purpose. See, that's why when Jesus was just a baby, the king of that time said, let me kill every male baby. Why? Why? Because if he could just stop the purpose. He said, I don't know which baby it is. So if we kill all of them, it'll stop the purpose of the Messiah. But I think Jesus sometimes jumped through walls and outside of walls. Why? Because he had a purpose. Come on, Father, we bless you this morning. Go ahead. We thank you so much for who you are. We ask you this morning that, Lord, you would allow us that's been called according to your purpose step into our happiness. That, Lord, we would no longer walk around and feel like you have no love for us and you can't use us. And we pray for those that's watching us. If they felt rejected or pushed away, or they feel like they don't fit in, We pray that your Holy Spirit would draw them and say, that is exactly what you're looking for. In Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord.
Come on, just respond to him this morning.